Yes. So today we are going to start with the poem The Snake Drawing. So The Snake Drawing, what this poem tells. So first of all, if I will ask you a general question, what would happen or what would be your reaction if you will see a snake? What is our first reaction? Yes. If you see a snake, suppose entering this room, what you will do? Huh? Kuch bhi nahi. Don't you feel afraid? Don't you feel terror? Some of you will not try to hit it with something in order to drive it away from the room. Some people, when they see a snake, what is their first reaction? To kill it immediately. Why? Because the snakes are venomous in nature. They are too poisonous. They can even cause a death. They can even cause a death of the victim when they bite them. Okay, so what snakes? Snakes are generally considered to be quite, you can say, synonymous to that of terror. Okay, so this is the general reaction to that of snakes of all the people. So similarly, in this poem, the poet, he has seen a snake, and because of being afraid, what he has done, he has thrown a stick over it in order to kill it. But the snake, who is very, the snakes are very active. They are very active. Okay. So what happened to them? They are very active. They immediately, with their wriggling as well as agile movements, it has gone into the reeds of the grass. It means it escaped that attack. So this poem is quite similar to that of one of the poem which was earlier in the syllabus of class 10. Not now, as the code has changed. Okay, when your 9th class was changed. And the poem, name of the poem was Snake. It was by D.H. Lawrence. In that also, it was intense hot weather. And the poet, who has come out of his room to fetch and to fill a jug of water for drinking, as he was feeling thirsty because of hot weather. And when he has come out of his room into the open from the tap, what he has seen? He has seen that the snake, it was trying to drink water from the trough which was filled on the side. From the tap, and under the tap, it was, you can say, it extended, it was protruding its lips in order to drink water and quench its thirst. Again, the same thought, it occurred in the mind of the poet to throw a stick on the snake and to kill it immediately. He picked up a log of wood also to throw it on the snake. But what happened? The snake, again with its curved movements, immediately it has gone into the opening of the wall. So what this signifies? It means that this is a common, you can say, reaction of every person to see a snake, pick up anything and to kill the snake. This is a common reaction of all. But in that poem, the poet was feeling, immediately the poet was regretting of his act. Why he was regretting of his act? That he thought that the snake has come to my house as a guest. He was repenting over his action of throwing a stick. He was repenting that why he has thrown a stick on it. It has come like a guest to his house and he must have welcomed him. So, in that poem also, the poet wants to deliver the message that human beings, although they are quite intelligent, they are equipped with the power of knowledge, but they should also follow the policy of live and let live. Similarly, in this poem, the poet is also delivering the message that one should let other creatures on this earth to live in harmony with them, to live freely. And one should not interrupt and intrude in the freedom that is provided to all the creatures. And most of the time, snakes, or not all snakes are venomous, not all snakes are poisonous. About 90% snakes, they are non-poisonous. Okay? But this is a misconception that all the snakes are poisonous. And This is of course reality. Those who are poisonous, they are extremely poisonous that they can cause death of the victim. This is reality. We can't deny this fact. But okay, let me ask you one more general question. Have you ever seen a snake dying? Or do you know that how a snake dies? Have you ever seen a snake dying in a natural way on the road or anywhere else? Then how the snake dies? You know, there is a very interesting fact about the death of snakes, that whenever a snake feels that my life should be over and now the time has come that I should get rid of this life, I should be dead, what the snake used to do, he would go and perch on a tree, on a top of the tree. There the snake would sit for many days without eating anything. And then ultimately, for how many days an organism or for how many days an animal can live without food? Not much. And ultimately, the snake dies. You must have seen snakes killed by a person. Someone is killing a snake. Someone is hitting it with, you can say, sharp object. Or someone is, you can say, killing it with stick. But have you ever seen the natural death of snake? No. Then ultimately, when the snake dies, its body, it is dried up and it is clinged to that. Finally, when it is dried up completely, it has fallen to the ground. This is the natural way of a snake to be dead. Okay. Even I have read it somewhere. Someone has told that I have got it from a video by Sadhguru. And he was saying that he has even tried to feed this snake with rats and frogs. But the snake was so, you can say he was so resolute that he would not eat anything. He decided, or the snake has decided, that I should submit my life. Then ultimately it was not eating anything. See, this much sense is there. Okay? So although that there are different levels of development of brain in all the human beings, right? So similarly, every creature is behaving in its way, and nature is so great, so generous in its nature, that to every organism, nature is providing its healing properties also and how to grow out of it. So man should not intrude in the lives of other creatures and should let them live. Just out of terror, we should not think that snakes are always poisonous in nature. Okay? So this is something general about snakes. Let us start the poem. Very short poem, quite easy. Now, first of all, most of you think of snakes are fearsome symbols of death. Yes, this I have discussed with you. But the snake in this poem is itself a victim. Yes, this is important question here. Okay, I will discuss it in the end, that whether the snake is a victim here or not. Okay, so let us see what happens. The snake trying to escape the pursuing stick. So the snake was trying, it means that the poet has seen the snake and thinking it that it is venomous in nature, it has picked up a he has picked up a stick and has thrown over the snake in order to kill it. Pursuing means following. It means the snake was, with its wriggling movements, it was moving forward in order to save itself from the stick that was following him. So now, the first thing that I want to discuss here is transferred epithet. Anybody can tell me what is transferred epithet? This is a literary device. Yes. What is transferred epithet? I have already told you a number of times. Anybody in the online class also? Literary device, transferred epithet. So, what is transferred epithet? First of all, here pursuing stick is transferred epithet. Note down in your books how. What is transferred epithet? It is used with the noun but It refers to the other noun with which it is used. With which it is used. See the meaning. It is used with, stick is noun, it is first line. It is used with, this pursuing, it is used with noun. But this pursuing, it is not referring to this stick. What pursuing kisko refer kar raha hai? To whom it is referring this pursuing? Snake. It means that it is used with the noun, but this is not referring to stick. It is referring to some other noun. That's why the name is transferred. Okay? Right? So, pursuing stick is transferred epithet. Okay? With sudden curvings of thin, long body. And immediately what happened? The snake is trying to escape from the following stick, from the stick which has been thrown by the poet towards it. And with its immediate curving movements, it was moving away. From these four lines, you have come to know there is no rhyme scheme. Okay? No rhyme scheme for this poem. Reverse. How beautiful. How beautiful and graceful are his shapes. And how beautiful and graceful. See, that how beautiful and graceful, it means that the poet has also related beauty to this phenomenal creature. That the snake is quite beautiful. It seems very beautiful when it is making its curving movements. Okay? And he glides. Glides means immediately moves through, or you can say, he glides through the water away from the stroke. Oh, let him go over the water into the reeds to hide without hurt. He glides. He immediately moves, makes sudden movements so that it can escape that stick and has where it has gone from the water near the stroke. Near some water is there from that stroke. He wanted to go, that the snake should go into the reeds of grass. Okay, reeds of grass where it could not be seen and where it could be saved from being hurt. Small and green, he is harmless even to children. And the poet is mentioning here again the fact that this snake, this is really harmless because it is green in color. But this doesn't mean that all green snakes are harmless. But this snake being green in color, it is harmless even for children. And it will not affect and it will not cause any harm to the children. Along the sand, he lay until observed and chased away, and now he vanishes in the ripples. Ripples means movements, wavy movements among the green slim reeds. So on the sand, because the color of the snake, it camouflaged. Camouflage means mixes with the background. It was camouflaged in the sand, and now where it has gone? It has gone into the reeds of the grass to remain unidentified there, so that it can remain unidentified in the reeds of the grass. Again, the snake, again the poet, he wants to deliver the message that is not to kill the snakes. They all snakes are not at all poisonous. We should not try to solve them. We should not try to kill them. Okay? And we should also, we always try to kill snakes, but not all snakes are poisonous. We also have the right to live on this earth. Quite a simple point. Okay? So any doubt? Yes, I forgot to discuss with you that small and green, he is harmless even to children. He is harmless. There is prominence of the sound. He is H. So this is alliteration. This is alliteration. Okay? Clear? So these are the main literary devices used here. Very short poem. And any doubt to any student, raise up your hand so that I can clear. Otherwise, I'll proceed towards discussion of the question answers. It's fine. Everything is clear online as well as offline. So first of all, let us focus upon textual questions. The first question is, what is the snake trying to escape from? Yes, the snake is trying to escape from the pursuing stick, which was thrown by a human being in order to kill him. And thinking that the snakes are poisonous or venomous in nature, it was an act that was performed in order to save themselves. Okay. Is it a harmful snake and what is it? No, right. It is not a harmful snake because it is green in color. And according to the poet, it is mentioned in the poem that it is harmless. It is green in color, small and green. He is harmless even to children. These lines, they depict this fact. Next question. The poet finds the snake beautiful. Find the word he uses to convey its beauty. Yes. Beautiful and graceful. His shapes are beautiful and graceful. And curvings of the body. Certain curvings of the body. Right. Yes. What? Okay. Thin and green, slim. You can also write down. Next is, what does the poet wish for the snake? Yes, the poet wishes for the escape of the snake, for the so that the snake could escape the attack of the snake. It should not be hurt and it should camouflage itself in the green reeds of grass. Okay, clear? Okay, very simple questions these are. Where was the snake before? Anyone saw it and chased it away? Where does the snake disappear? Earlier, where it was? It has settled up on the sand. Where it has, its body has camouflaged its surroundings. It was unidentified. And when it was moving its curving movements, where it was going into the reeds of the grass in order to escape from any kind of attack and in order to save itself. Okay? Understood? Any doubt in all these five questions? Okay. Let us discuss some extra questions I am writing here on the board side by side. The first question is, what do you know about the person? Come to know about the person who is attacking the snake. What do you know about the person who is attacking the snake? Yes. What do you know about the person? These questions I have already shared in the group. Because when I have done this poem in class C and D, I have already sent. Yes. What do you know about the person who is attacking the snake? That the person is quite afraid of the snake. He is in terror of the scene, or he is in terror to see a sight of the snake, or he is in terror at the sight of the snake. And in order to save himself, what he has done, he has thrown a stick over the snake in order to kill him or in order to drive him away from that place. Okay. Next question. What does the poet wish for the snake? What does the poet wish for the snake? What he is wishing for the snake? For its escape, that he should immediately move with its curving movements into the reeds of the grass, so that where it cannot be chased or it cannot be hurt. So tell me, in this poem, whether the snake, or is the snake a victim? Victim or a threat? Yes. What do you think? That the snake is victim or threat? Of course it's a victim because the snake is chased by the stick. Snake is escaping from the pursuing stick. Snake is trying to save itself from the stick that was following him. Someone has thrown a stick towards the snake in order to kill it. So it's not a threat to life. Moreover, even the poet has mentioned that these green snakes, they are non-poisonous and they cannot even cause harm to young children. So these So here the snake is a victim. What does the poet mean? What does the poet mean when he says, "Oh, let him go"? What does the poet mean when he says, "Oh, let him go"? Yes. What does the poet mean when he says, "Oh, let him go"? What does he mean?
That
it is harmless. Okay, it is harmless, and he should be allowed to go away without being hurt. And it should, earlier it has camouflaged its body with the surroundings, while you can say settling on the sand, but now it should go away into the reeds of the green reeds of the grass. Okay, so what is the message of the poem? That snakes are not always poisonous. We should not try to attack them, and not all are poisonous. Like other creatures, we should allow them to live a life of their own, and they should be in harmony with nature. Clear? So by this, any problem in this poem? By this, the poem is complete. Okay? Any doubt to any student, you can raise up your hand. Test. Huh? Syllabus? Yes. Yes, yes, sure, I will. Okay? I have already sent few days back. Okay, I will. Okay? So now, next, we are going to revise article writing. So what is an article? You know that it is a descriptive account, or it is a composition about a particular subject in which the person writes his or her views, and it is meant to be published in newspapers or magazines. Okay? Speech and article, they are similar to each other in the way the ideas are being presented, in the way one can write a speech or an article. The only difference between a speech and an article is that the speech is always conversative in nature. Okay? Means you are using interactive language, you are using some conversative expressions. For example, let us assume I want to deliver you the fact. You will hardly believe this fact. Okay? I suppose that, do you know that I want to bring to your notice? Like in this manner, you involve the audience in speech. But in article, because it is not meant to be spoken in front of the audience, so what is an article? As it is meant to be written in newspapers and articles, so an article does not involve any kind of these expressions. Rest, all the things are almost the same in case of speech and article. It includes the introduction and development of the topic also, right? So there are mainly two type of articles. As I have already discussed with you when I discussed this topic, argumentative and descriptive. Argumentative means when you present your arguments for a topic, and you want to persuade, you want to convince the readers about your point. And okay, you give explanations, you give arguments, you want to persuade the audience what you want to deliver and to make them believe that whatever you are saying is absolutely right. Next is descriptive, in which you are describing the things or physically what you see, what you observe around your surroundings. In that you describe the various facts. Okay? So, you know, for writing an article, it demands accurate, perfect, and high degree of creativity. It also demands good use of vocabulary, coherence in ideas. That means your ideas, what you are going to present, it should be related to the point. you should not go so deep while writing an article that you go astray. You forget the actual point what you are writing and you have moved to some other line of thought. No. Okay? And you should have different range of vocabulary and thorough knowledge of the topic. Okay? So let us discuss the format of a layout of an article. So, first of all, you know that you are writing title or heading in capitals. This title or heading, it should be short, thought-provoking, precise, in capital letters, and it can be a phrase, it can be an idiom, not a complete sentence. Okay? Understood? Right? So, in the byline, next line, by ABC, the person who is writing an article. Clear? Understood? So, first of all, when you can also add on quote or quotation after that. It depends. Right? So, first of all, you will give an introduction of the topic. Introduction means you will, so first of all, set up the context about the topic. What you are going to speak. Okay? Topic sentence. For every paragraph, there is a topic sentence. Concentrate here only on the board. So topic sentence, it establishes the context. For every sentence, there is a top. For every paragraph, there is always a topic sentence. Means first one or two sentences, they can be the topic sentences. Means which are going to explain or which contains the gist of the complete paragraph. It means what you are going to discuss in this. Okay? So it delimits the topic. Topic sentence, it delimits the topic and it establishes the context in which you are going to write an article. Okay? Put the topic in perspective before the audience. Okay? That what you are going to speak. For example, if I will talk about use of mobile phones. Okay? Mobile phones as boom. Okay? Then how you will start that, for example, how you will establish the context. Today, with the development of each and every field, there is one new invention, that is of mobile phones, which has revolutionized our lives. We cannot imagine our day starting without opening our mobile phone. It has, you can say, replaced all the other gadgets in our life, which are otherwise important. The first thing that is being replaced by mobile is the, you can say, is the wristwatch. Okay, so it means that you are going to explain, you are going to tell something about mobile phones. Okay, so introduction. Then, para 2, you can put a rhetorical question to the audience. For example, did you know that? In order to give an exercise to their minds. Okay? Clear? You want to put the perspective in front of the audience. Then afterwards, we will have exposition of topic or development of the topic. So, in development of topic, you will make different paragraphs for it. There is no hard and fast rule that how many paragraphs you will make. Okay? So, para 3, one para. Exposition of the topic, describe the topic in detail, what you are going to deliver. Okay, use some evidences, examples, statistics means data, in order to emphasize upon the topic. For example, suppose statistics, for example, today out of 99.9% people are equipped with this modern gadget, that is mobile phone. Okay, with the onset of dawn, our day starts not with exercise but with visualizing the notifications of our mobile phone. Okay, and this would help us to check out the weather conditions. Okay, and to see the reminders of our appointments to be held during the day, and this will also help. This has also replaced our diary. okay, our planner. And you can also use some evidences. For example, I'm using evidences of daily life, na, that how our day starts, what we are doing. Okay, so you can use, you can write down in this manner. Okay, next afterwards. So this is, for example, we are describing that how it is useful. But sometimes when it is argumentative in nature, you can write down if something has, you as you can talk about both the positive as well as the negative prospects of a thing or of a topic. Then you can also give its causes. Okay, why it is happening. Okay. Mention causes, how it is affecting the life of people and in society in general. Okay, clear? Then afterwards, you can make one para of merits, demerits, advantages, disadvantages. When you are writing about merits, demerits, advantages and disadvantages, so naturally you will make one paragraph for suggestions. Okay, you will give suggestions that how can it be wisely used. It has caused a lot of problem in our lives. Okay, but ultimately what should be done? It should be wisely used. Okay, you can give various examples. Then ultimately, winding up, here you summarize your views. Do not repeat. Give some, it signals the approaching end. Then finally, conclusion, conclude with a positive point or conclude by giving your viewpoint. Okay, or you can give your opinion. Or a question or an appeal for the audience, for the readers. And that's it. This is an article. Okay? Clear? Don't forget to write down the heading. Next, byline, the writer. Clear? Various topics can be given. But what you observe around yourself, what you have observed is actually to be presented in the form of article. It is a long piece of writing. So I hope that everything is clear to you all as I have given the general explanation of the topic. Okay, clear? So thank you very much.